It has been a tumultuous year for retailers as inflation and higher rates fluctuate consumer behavior. Yet resilience in consumer spending did peek through amid economic headwinds, revealing bright spots that can shape the wider consumer landscape in the coming year. Here to discuss the retail trends to watch, we have RJ Hottovy, Placer AI Head of Analytical Research. It's good to see you, RJ, especially with a different hat than when we used to talk to you. So I appreciate you joining us. So it's interesting when we look at the retail trends that you're expecting in the coming year. And I found a lot of them have to do with people not just spending on stuff still, but spending around doing things. Even if they're buying stuff, it's sort of experience related.
Yeah, there really is this kind of experiential or almost fear of missing out element when people are looking to spend right now. We saw experiences were one of the key categories of growth last year. And if you look at things like the Taylor Swift concert or Beyonce or even Barbenheimer, the movie phenomenon, the halo effect that had on other retailers was absolutely phenomenal. So I think that's been a big trend. People are looking to spend. We see it in the restaurant category. We see it with players like Kura Sushi, the revolving sushi bar, or Gen Korean Barbecue, where you actually cook at the table. People are looking to actually do different things when they dine out or have experiences. And retailers and restaurants are starting to figure this out. I mean, McDonald's has done a lot of promotions with celebrities. Other players are starting to get in this game too as well. So very much an experiential, very much a community experience kind of aspect to what we're seeing in the experiences right now.
And RJ, I just want to double click on restaurants for a second, because you know that category as well as anybody. Yeah. One interesting theme to call out that you called out, RJ, was dining concepts focused on serving suburbia will see growth in 2024. Yeah. How come, RJ? What's the theme there you're playing?
Yeah, it's a migration play, and I don't think it's gotten full appreciation by the market. This big, massive shift we've seen away from urban markets to suburban and even rural locations has dramatically changed the real estate strategy for a lot of retailers out there. Instead of focusing on urban markets where you can go after workers, and we've seen some improvement in return to work this year, but we have seen it's almost stalled out, and a lot of people still continue to work from home. And so I think that this movement, players like Cava and Chipotle have really prioritized more suburban locations, and I think that's going to continue to play out. The other aspect to this too is that the market that you built a location on 4 or 5 years ago has changed no matter what market you're in. Maybe it is that suburban to urban to suburban movement, but also we've seen a lot of movement to Southeast markets, Dallas, Houston, Florida, Tampa, Orlando, Key, Carolinas. All these markets have seen a lot of growth, and not just population growth. In many markets, we've seen a lot of higher household income market population growth as well. So I think that these markets are going to be ripe for expansion, a lot of restaurant retail growth in these markets, but also probably M&A activity. We saw Aldi acquire Winn-Dixie in the Southeast. That's not going to be the last deal that capitalizes on that migration pattern.
And another sort of related trend to what you're talking about is a term I wasn't familiar with, but I'm certainly familiar with the phenomenon, placemaking. In other words, sort of these planned developments, if you will, that are mixed use that almost create sort of town squares in some cases. We've seen that trend over the past couple of years. Do you think we're going to see an acceleration or just sort of a thriving of the ones that already exist? How's that going to pan out?
I think we're going to see an acceleration. I mean, I think at this point now that a lot of the commercial real estate properties that you pointed out that had adopted a mixed-use strategy, whether it's a community square, or apartment buildings, or other ways to better engage with those consumers, we're seeing some real positive results. If you look at those properties that have implemented those kind of features, we see a lot higher visit frequency. We see the trade area that they pull from being a lot wider. And we see it continuing, too. It's not like this is just a one-time effect. We're seeing some real positive results. So I think a lot of commercial real estate properties are going to continue this trend and change the way they go about not only building a particular property, maybe they're going to renovate it, too, and have more of these community aspects to it, too. It also changes who you pick in terms of tenants for these locations as well. But what's interesting, too, is it also starting to change at the tenant level. Higher interest rates right now, people are looking to maximize return on their physical assets. And so you're seeing things like, maybe we'll add a car wash to a gas station location, maybe a pickup window at a full-service restaurant. Maybe it's, some of these larger retailers that are looking at retail media. Hey, maybe we can get some advertising revenue from our physical store spaces as well. So it's really changing the way things about it. So placemaking is really taking place at both commercial real estate and retail. Some really interesting things taking place there.
And RJ, also get your take on the grocery industry in 2024 as well. We're waiting to see how Kroger, Albertsons, how that merger, plays out. But what do you see for that industry in 2024? Do you see more consolidation, RJ?
I do. I think we're going to see more M&A activity. I think a lot of it driven by migration and where people have moved to. But I also think there's just other industry trends. I mean, if you look at grocery this year, value was really the number one trend. But it's not just low prices. I think that's oversimplifying it. I think it really came down to innovation at the value price. And so those that are doing new things at the bottom price, new SKUs, new flavor profiles. You know, Trader Joe's is a perfect example of this, where people are looking at what new products are on the shelves every month. So I think we're going to see more and more of that, M&A activity there too. But very much still focus on value. I think it is the players like Grocery Outlet and Aldi's and the dollar stores to some extent too that are really capitalizing on this movement. But again, it's not just having the low prices. I think right now it really is about creating excitement at that value price point.
Speaking of value and sort of adding on sustainability, one of the other trends you see is continued secondhand apparel demand, or I guess not just apparel demand. And this is interesting to me because while anecdotally it feels like that's caught hold, if you look at some of the publicly traded companies that play in that space, they haven't all done that great. So how do you think that is going to evolve over the coming year?
I think the demand is there. I think we're certainly seeing it, particularly among that younger consumer who's just starting out the professional career. They still want to kind of stand out. There's still this individualistic aspect to it. And that was one of the actual trends we started to see later in the year. Some of the apparel retailers that kind of focus on more individualistic styles really did pretty well compared to the rest of the category, despite having some discretionary spending headwinds. So I think that we're going to continue to see this demand for secondhand. I think as a category, I think there's still some infrastructure that needs to be built out, some things that, from a professionalism standpoint, just kind of that industry needs to mature a bit more. But I think there still is a demand. So I think that's going to continue to play on 2024. And again, it plays in this idea of value, but not just low prices, something unique that I'm not getting somewhere else. And I think secondhand really fulfills a lot of that.
RJ, it's always good to see you. Thank you for joining us today and for those insights.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.